people that don't even watch movies.
That's true.
Like, just share it with everybody. Share it with your grandma.
I think you should share it with a Kardashian.
Okay, yeah. Well, maybe not the Kardashians.
Then they'll retweet it, and then a million other people will watch it.
I swear I would not mention the word Kardashians on the show, but you beat me to it, Andrew. So every week we are joined by an esteemed panel of critics, of film lovers and experts. And this week I'm joined by two very respected film pundits and very, very close friends, my good friend Matt Atchity, member of the Broadcast Film Critics Association.
I'm very excited to be here.
Very excited to have you here, my friend. And of course, Andrew Freund, also a member of the Broadcast Film Critics Association, TV host, critic, pundit. This guy is everywhere.
One more. Give me one more.
Handsome.
Okay.
Devilishly handsome.
Okay, I'll take that. I'll take that.
Okay, well, we're going to have a very, very fun time. Very lively conversation talking about the new movies in theaters. First up, let's get right to it with White Boy Rick. The film is directed by Jan Demange. It stars Richie Merritt, Matthew McConaughey, Jennifer Jason Leigh, and R.J. Seiler, based on the true story of Richard Wersch Jr., a Detroit teenager who became an undercover informant for the FBI during the war on drugs in the 1980s. Matt Atchity, what did you think of White Boy Rick?
I thought it was fine.
Fine. Why was it just fine?
I think that this movie struggles to really make an impactful story and tries. And so, you know, Rick Wershe was, as a 14, 15-year-old, working as an informant for the FBI, and then later gets arrested and convicted of being one of the larger drug dealers in the Detroit area. And, you know, this is not a spoiler because it's all in history and they've been talking about it a bunch. There was a law at the time that said if you had more than 650 grams of coke, then you were considered basically a major distributor.
Wow.
And you would get a life sentence. Mm-hmm. So he got a life sentence. Now, the movie goes and tries to portray this as the government basically setting him up. But the timeline, even within the movie, doesn't match up, because by the time he's when he is distributing, when he's selling drugs and starts his own kind of empire, he's on his own at this point. And so when the movie kind of in the third act tries to make it this big tragedy, like, oh, the government set him up, I don't really think that that's, the movie doesn't do a good job of really enforcing that. Now, that being said, I think that there's some interesting stuff going on in here. The guy playing the lead never acted before. You know,
right, it was Richie Merritt.
Merritt was part of a, you know, McConaughey has been talking about how a talent scout found him. They were doing casting calls, you know, they sent casting directors out to schools, and one of them went to the school, and to hear McConaughey tell it, the principal at the school didn't really think that they were being serious, that the director was serious. And he's like, well, try this kid who happened to be in the principal's office. Now, I think he does fine, right?
Right.
Like, working opposite some of the actors he's working opposite is a tall order. And I think this kid's relatively grounded, and I kind of bought that he was caught up in a lot of things going on.
Yeah, I did too.
I was impressed with the performances. I think the script lets, and the direction kind of meanders, and I think it lets the story down a little bit.
I do agree with that. Okay, Andrew, your take on White Boy Rick.
So I'll preface this by saying I saw this film at 9 a.m., last Sunday in TIFF. I was slightly hungover, so.
Oh, wow.
It's not the best hangover movie to watch at 9 a.m.
Super bummer way to start off the day.
Whew, it was a doozy.
9 a.m., Jesus.
But Matt hit the nail on the head. It was just convoluted. Like, the timelines didn't match up, and so I'm watching it, and I'm like, is this my hangover, or am I just not understanding what's going on right?
Maybe a little bit of both.
It's probably a little bit of both. but I also thought the pacing was so slow. I was like, how long is this movie? It was just kind of dragged on and on. I will say, I thought that the performance by his daughter was pretty good.
Oh, she was fantastic.
And she looked just terrible in the whole thing.
She looked totally strung out.
Then I saw her at the junk and I was like, thank God you look so much better. but she plays a junkie, so she's not supposed to look.
Yeah, I'm kind of in between you two guys. I agree with your points on the film. I do think it meanders. I feel like it is a bit of a, there's no focus to it. It doesn't have any focus. And it does meander, and it does get quite convoluted. But then at the end, because of Matthew McConaughey, who plays his father, who is basically a lowlife and a scumbag for much of the film, and his priorities are completely out of whack, so something happens, and he just brings a big heart to the movie, and it ends well. It ends strong. For the first hour or so, I thought that the lead actor, Richie Mara, was very, very strong, and he really held the movie as best as he could, despite the fact that it wasn't very well directed. It didn't have that focus, but he did have great chemistry with Matthew McConaughey as his father, and their bond is really kind of seals the deal. I thought the movie was okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't love it.
Yeah, I'd be interesting to see this script and this cast working with a more sure-handed director who really mm-hmm. could get a more solid performance, because Merritt comes off as lost in a lot of this movie, and I think mm-hmm. he's supposed to, but there are moments where I think you want to see more emotion from him, and I think the director doesn't do a great job of coaxing it out of him, and you see that the rest of the cast does a good job supporting him. You know, when McConaughey has his big moment, you kind of, it's like, you could almost see the relief in his face, like, finally, I get to actually kind of swing for the fences in this. And look, this movie, you're right, it does end strong, which is rare, because, you know, there's another movie we'll talk about which I think ends weak.
Yeah.
Ending stronger is tough to do in a movie if the beginning of the movie is weak, and I think that somewhat redeemed the experience for me. But it is kind of all over the place and kind of a mess. You could cut 20 minutes out of this movie.
Yeah, I agree
think
with
it'd
that.
Be a lot tighter.
Please, Andrew. I agree with Matt. I also think that he's not really acting, the lead, Merritt. I mean, because he's not an actor. I mean, this is his first role. And then when I met him, that's really who he is.
Yeah, yeah. When I did the interview with him in Toronto, I'm like, oh, he looks exactly the same, by the way.
That's who he is.
That's who he is. Which is okay.
Totally okay.
Especially if it's just your first movie.
And look, there are actors that are like that, right? There are actors that are out there that inhabit one specific space and they don't really get out of it. And I'd say he's one of the, you know, has that potential to be that guy.
Totally. And listen, more power to him. His first movie, he's acting with Matthew McConaughey. So, hey, hands down.
Okay, what's your letter grade if you had to get a letter grade on this movie?
I would say C+.
C+, Matt?
Yeah, I'd say a C+.
Okay, I give it a B-. You know, again, it's not like a movie. It's not a glowing recommendation to see it in theaters. Maybe, you know, when it rolls around, like streaming on iTunes, or maybe it's on Netflix, Amazon, or
American
whatever.
American Airlines.
Yeah, American Airlines. Yeah, it's a good airplane movie, right?
Shout out to American Airlines.
Go American Airlines. Well, maybe even Delta, because they have a great selection on their airplanes. All right, let's move right along to A Simple Favor, directed by Paul Feig, who did Bridesmaids and The Heat. The movie stars Anna Kendrick and Blake Lively. Anna Kendrick plays Stephanie, a mommy blogger who becomes best friends with Emily, who's kind of mysterious, played by Blake Lively. And when Emily disappears, Stephanie tries to look for her, but she may not like what she finds. I mean, that sounds like a line out of Planet of the Apes, but it is very applicable here. Okay, Andrew, what did you think of A Simple Favor?
So I have not seen this film, but however, the marketing campaign has hooked me. Because I've seen, you know, the girls have been on all the talk shows, and there's a social media campaign. I don't know if you've noticed it on your iPhones. So I'm very intrigued by this film.
Okay. Let me ask you a question. Yeah. What are you expecting? Because I have concerns about this marketing. What is it, if you were to give me a couple of movies that it's making you think of?
So it's making me think of, what's the movie with the Ryan Felipe, the old school Sarah Michelle Gellar?
Cruel Intentions?
Cruel Intentions.
Yeah.
That's kind of what it's making me think of. It's making me think it's like a sexy thriller with comedic undertones.
Okay, well, that kind of is what it is,
see,
Matt.
My concern with the marketing, I'm worried about this movie, because I'll preface this by saying I like this movie a lot.
I do too.
I think this is a really sharp movie, and they kind of bobble the ending a little bit. But for the most part, I really, really like this. I like to see Paul Feig really stretching himself as a director. I think that the marketing for this movie is making it come off almost like Gone Girl on one extreme, because I've heard some people talk about that's what they're expecting. That's not what this movie is.
No. That was David Fincher. This is Paul Feig.
Well, but that's the thing, right? Like, Fincher has this really, really dark tone. And Feig doesn't, right? Feig is this really lighter filmmaker. And as much as he is, this is absolutely a film noir story.
Yep.
This is not a dark noir, right? Like, I would argue, even if you're looking at dark stories by a guy like Spielberg, Spielberg's got a real, like, humanist, kind of optimistic view. And even in Feig stuff where he's really, you know, poking at people, like, he's got this humanist, optimistic view in his filmmaking. And that's what's going on here. I think that there is terrific chemistry between Kendrick and Lively, and I would absolutely watch them do more movies together. Mm-hmm. This movie does go in a lot of really interesting places. I think, look, Blake Lively is crazy sexy in this movie.
And she's just it's a great performance.
Yeah, she's this, you know, imagine like the overworked mom, like the overworked mom version of a femme fatale. That's what you have here, right? Mm-hmm. And Anna Kendrick is, you know, she's the character that you'd see in a Hitchcock movie who gets caught up in things bigger than she is.
I'm glad you brought that up,
right?
Because the movie does feel like a Hitchcock movie of sorts.
Of sorts. Who is it in Rear Window?
Grace Kelly.
Well, no, the lead, the guy.
Jimmy Stewart.
Right. Like she makes me think like she's kind of in a Jimmy Stewart spot in this.
I want to see this movie
now. It's really good.
She starts off as this like innocent but yet smart, you know, overachieving. And then as you unpack her a little bit, and the movie takes its time to unpack who she is. And what's great is by the time you get to the end of the movie and bigger things are happening, the movie has laid enough groundwork that it really earns those beats. So when you see Kendrick's character make these really, really sharp moves, well, they've earned that, right? And those people that watch me on What the Flick will know that that's one of my drinking words. Like, if we say earned, you get the word. So I have plenty. But I really like this movie. And I also liked the guy who was the husband, who we just saw in Crazy Rich Asians.
Mm-hmm. Henry.
Henry, yeah.
Golding.
I think he's great in this. I think he'd be a great James Bond if we're looking to cast James Bond. But anyway, I know everybody will be mad. You can't have an Asian James Bond. Anyway, I think this movie's really fun. It's one of those movies that go in with an open mind because, you know, I think some of the knocks you're going to get against this movie is that it's neither fish nor fowl. It is a mystery, but it's got a lot of humor to it, but it is not... It's not the spoof that you get with Spy, right? Like Spy...
I heard there's a lot of martinis in the film.
There are a lot of martinis. So Spy, similar to Edgar Wright's movies, which is... Spy is an effective spy movie that spoofs spy movies, right? Edgar Wright makes, you know, an effective zombie movie.
Shaun of the Dead, yeah.
But he spoofs them with... you know, he can do action movies that are spoofs of action movies, but are still good action movies like Hot Fuzz. This one is not spoofing the mystery.
Yeah, I don't think of it as a spoof.
Right, and I'm a little worried people are going to go into that, but this is a lighter but still really smart mystery, and I liked it a lot.
Okay, I look at it more as a dark comedy thriller, Hitchcockian in some ways, because yes, Anna Kendrick does play like the Jimmy Stewart role, and what I like about Anna Kendrick in the film is her arc. Like she starts the movie, she's totally naive. She's a real pushover, and she, like as an actor to play the kind of arc that Anna Kendrick does in this movie is a testament to her how great of an actor she is. And Blake Lively is fantastic in the movie. I love the mystery of it. Like, who is this Blake Lively character? Where did she go? Why did she want to be friends with Anna Kendrick's character?
She really is
place?
That Hitchcockian blonde, like that mysterious
that
blonde.
Femme that fatale. Hitchcock. She absolutely is. And just the setup and the mystery of, like, where is this going? Like, the more I was asking questions about the film, the more I liked it. The problem is at the end, okay? And here's what I mean.
No spoilers.
There's no spoiler. I promise you this is not going to spoil anything.
Right.
But Matt, you mentioned talking about the last movie that White Boy Rick ended strong and another movie didn't. I'm assuming you're talking about A Simple Favor. Because I thought the problem with the ending of A Simple Favor, again, no spoilers, is that it's over-explained. It goes on
so
too long.
Right.
They explain everything.
There's two problems I have with the ending here. Is one, I think by the time they get to the very end, they've written themselves into a corner.
Yeah.
And so at that point, like any explanation, because they've spent so many times laying out, oh, but then this and that and this, that by the time you get to something, it's going to be unsatisfying.
Yeah.
Coupled with there's one particular scene that I'm not going to spoil this, but there's one particular scene, and if people want to see the movie and hit me on Twitter and ask me about it, I'll explain which one it is. There's one scene where you feel like they're setting something up that it tips into like unreliable narration, and that somewhat bugged me. But again, I really like this movie. I think Anna Kendrick is great. You know what movie this is a measure of how old you and I are. I'll tell you what this makes me think of. Two movies. Silver Streak.
Oh, I love Silver Streak. Right?
And what was the other one that they did where they were in jail?
Oh, Stir Crazy.
Stir Crazy.
Yeah.
So you put these two comedic actors in a mystery movie,
right?
In an escape movie.
Oh, that's a great comparison.
So those two movies, and you don't see movies like that anymore, right? Silver Streak is a mystery movie, right?
1976.
Great movie. And it's Gene Wilder and Richard Pryor, and they play off each other, and they have great comedic timing.
Yep.
But Gene Wilder's character is in a mystery in that movie. Like it's like you drop these two comics into what would otherwise be this kind of straightforward mystery movie. And Stir Crazy is somewhat the same way because it ends up being this, you know, almost drama about prison life.
Yeah.
Right? And, you know, what if you drop two comedic actors in this? So it's almost like, what if you drop, you know, two comedic actors, and I think we don't get to see Blake Lively be funny enough.
Because Anna Kendrick, I don't think of her, I mean, even though she did, you know, like Pitch Perfect, and I mean, she's given humor to a lot of her performances, including her Oscar-nominated performance in Up in the Air, which, I mean, she was brilliant.
I would put her definitely as someone that she's reliable in a comedy.
She's great actress.
Blake Lively, I think, is somewhat the surprise here in that you don't get to see her do funny enough. Like, she gets cast as these beautiful, kind of almost unreachable women, and she's funny in this. And again, like, I want to see her.
We forgot about trolls.
Oh, trolls. I mean, listen, yeah, she can sing too. Let's not forget that. She's definitely a triple threat. Drama, comedy, and she can sing. But overall, I thought that A Simple Favor was a very, very good movie. It was great up until the end, and that's knocked it down to just very, very good. But that's still like a very, very good thing to have in mid-September when the movies usually aren't very good. And Paul Feig, again, like you said, Matt, he is stretching himself. But he is still, like, as he's always done, just done really, really great films, really great, really gotten great performances out of female leads. Yeah. And I think that is great, especially
And I think that it's helped that he, you know, puts great material for his female leads, right?
Sure.
Like, if you think about Anna Kendrick's arc in this, like, she comes off as this almost Pollyanna-ish, you know, overly perfect kind of single mom who's just overachieving. And then you start to peel away the layers of that.
Yep.
And you get to someone that, like, oh, there's a darkness there. Oh, and Kendrick plays it really, really well you never at some point say, oh, that's not who that character was. You see, oh, that's how it ends up informing who the character is that we met at the beginning of the film.
Right.
Right. And so as you think back on it, you're, you know, and there's these little tiny hints, right? Like, have you ever dealt with the cops before? And there's that little quick shot, right? Or when she talks about her husband and, you know, her being the car accident. And there's that quick shot. And there's these little, like, that ratchet the tension up in what is otherwise this kind of comedic movie.
Letter grade.
I'm on the fence between an A- and a B+. I think I'm going to give it a B+.
Okay, I'm giving it a B+, too. It was an A- up until the last over-explained ending. Then it knocked it down to a B+. Still a very good movie. Okay, now we move on to The Predator. Yes, The Predator is back. I love the first two movies, even the second one. Predator 2 is really, really good. It's an underrated film. Very, very dark and definitely different from the first one. But Shane Black is the director. The film stars Olivia Munn, Jacob Tremblay, Sterling K. Brown. A young boy sort of triggers the return of the alien hunter to Earth, and it's up to a raging crew of ex-soldiers to save the human race. Okay, Andrew, talk to me about The Predator.
So it's funny. So I was been thinking about this for a while because when I went into it, I had seen so many heavy movies over the past few days. So when I went into it, I was like, it was just a kind of a breath of fresh air for me to have fun at a movie. Mm-hmm. So on a superficial level, I thought it was fun. I thought it, you know, was a nice little break for me. However, obviously the film has been tanked by controversy because there was a predator in Predator. And that has tainted my opinion on the film, especially seeing how the studio kind of handled it and how Olivia Munn said something to the studio and then they didn't do anything about it and they did do something about it, but then they didn't talk about it. So all of this, it really makes it kind of creepy in a way.
You know, here's the thing. I saw the movie last night and I've been reading it for the last few days about the controversy. First of all, just to review the film without the controversy, just with, without any of this stuff about how there was this predator in the film and Olivia Munn had addressed it to Fox and they didn't get back to her right away and they kind of wanted her to sort of like, you know, tone it down with like talking about it. It was not handled well and, you know, people came forward and apologized, but it was too late. Her cast members came forward to stand by her, but it was too late. Of taking all that out of the equation and to just review the film, it's terrible. It is a bad movie. This is a bad fucking movie. I hated this film. I'm sitting there watching this movie, and I gotta tell you, I like Shane Black a lot. I love Kiss Kiss Bang Bang. I thought Nice Guy was a very, very funny movie. And I gotta tell you, I really liked Iron Man 3. I liked that he took chances with Iron Man 3. And a lot of people didn't like Iron Man 3, but I liked it because it was different. It sort of deconstructed the Iron Man model, and it was different. It was more about Tony Stark than Iron Man, but I digress. But this film, it's a mess. It is a mess. There's a lot of stupid characters in the film. The movie is it's not suspenseful. I didn't have fun with it at all. Again, like in the first two films, especially, Predator was dangerous. And right. I didn't feel, he's killed people left and right in the movie, but it was gratuitous.
Yeah,
it was gratuitous
violence. There's not that
violence.
Sense of danger in this one. You're
yeah,
right.
Yeah, I mean, but you know, there's no buildup to the suspense like there was, especially in the first one with Schwarzenegger. And I got to tell you, you know, knowing what I know now about all the controversy, I'm watching the film, and all the characters in the movie, these like low-life ex-soldiers who are total scumbags, are treating Olivia Munn's character, who's a friggin' astrophysicist, a scientist. They're treating her like crap. They're treating her like dirt. And I'm watching the film knowing everything about the controversy. I mean, how do you not know about it right by now? And I'm really thinking like, boy, like even on screen, she's getting like a bad deal and she's not treated fairly. And I just felt like there was a misogynistic undertone of this movie that was really off-putting, not to mention the fact that it was just stupid. Matt.
I didn't see this movie.
Yes.
I'm boycotting this movie. Mm-hmm. And I have the luxury that I can do that. Mm-hmm. So, look, I'm not going to get, if somebody wants to go see this movie, go see this movie. Mm-hmm. I won't say I won't judge you, but, whatever. So, look, it's up to what matters to you. And if somebody feels like they want to go see that movie, that's their choice and that's fine. I will respect that. I'm not going to see this movie. This is really, I'm very, very, very disappointed in Shane Black. And I liked Nice Guys. I love Kiss Kiss Bang Bang.
Yeah.
This is the guy that gave us Lethal Weapon.
Yeah, he wrote Lethal Weapon,
He wrote Lethal Weapon. Mm-hmm. And, Kiss Kiss Bang Bang was a really, really great movie. Iron Man 3 has some really interesting stuff going on in it. I liked Nice Guys, but this controversy has actually made me turn on Nice Guys because I'm so pissed off at Shane Black. So the controversy is that Shane Black cast his good friend, Steven Wilder, also known as Steven Wilder Striegel, in a speaking role in this movie and Nice Guys and Iron Man 3, without telling anyone that Striegel had been convicted of trying to lure his 14-year-old cousin into a sexual relationship like 12 or 13 years ago.
It's crazy.
So now the original story says, well, there's, the law is such that apparently studios can't do deep background checks, whatever. He had to know. Black had to know.
Of course.
Right?
Yeah.
So the minute I saw that news break, I thought, okay, it's really bad that that Olivia Munn doesn't find out till after the fact. But here's where my head goes. And this is admittedly because I'm a parent. I think, okay, so Shane Black's this movie, The Predator, and Iron Man 3 and The Nice Guys all have kid actors in them.
Right.
And if this guy, if Steven Wilder Striegel is such a good buddy of Shane Black's that they've been living together, that is basically, Striegel is Black's Cato Kalin, basically, like has been living with him for years as a roommate and shows up in his movies, I guarantee you he's showing up at the premieres, right? And sure enough, I looked on Getty Images and there's pictures of Striegel and Angry Rice, who was then 13 years old, at The Nice Guys premiere.
Right.
And so I'm pretty sure Angry Rice's parents were not told that this guy who was convicted of trying to lure an underage girl into a sexual relationship was at this party.
Right.
Coupled with, it also makes me realize, like, here's where my head goes. And look, maybe I'm overthinking this, but the idea of Shane Black playing Holly March's character, played by Angry Rice, Ryan Gosling's daughter in Nice Guys, putting her at that porn star party and playing that for laughs, makes me think, oh, well, then maybe he didn't think that Striegel's conviction was that big a deal. Mm-hmm. Like, that's the kind of thing he, at least in one movie, played for laughs, right? Now, I know, look, there's going to be people that are pissed off that I feel this way, but that's, you know, that's where I am really, really disappointed in Shane Black, because it's yes, he apologized last night at the premiere. He said, I'm the captain, I made a mistake. But is he going to go back and apologize to everybody who worked on The Nice Guys?
Like, well, listen, I mean, you know, that comes down to just like, you know, like, you know, just, well, I want to bring it back to right. the film. But because this all came out, now he's apologizing.
Right.
He got caught.
Yeah,
everybody exactly. got caught. And right. it was not handled well, especially with regards to Olivia Munn, who was basically thrown to the wolves and, you know, still had to go to Toronto to right. to promote the movie.
And what's going to get messed up is Olivia Munn's now going to get the rep for being difficult.
No. Right.
No, she mean, might, behind she closed be, doors, but, right? Behind you know closed what? Doors, she's going to get the rep for being difficult. And that's not okay.
No. Well, I absolutely support yeah. her. I mean,
we love you, Olivia Munn.
We love you, Olivia Munn.
Come on the show anytime.
Back to the film itself. What yeah. letter grade would you give this piece of shit?
I would give
waiting
it
to witness, Your Honor.
One more thing I was going to say. I thought that Keegan-Michael Key was hilarious in this movie.
And I thought he was obnoxious.
I thought he was super funny. I'm a huge fan of his, and I could see some of Shane Black's comedic prowess within Keegan's character. So that was kind of the strongest, for me, that was the strongest part of this film was Keegan, because I just kind of love the guy. I would give it a C+.
Yeah, I'd give it a D. I mean, again, I'm just reviewing the film.
Yeah.
And I'm just, you know, with everything that was said about how this whole situation was handled, even if none of that was part of the case, there this misogynistic undertone to the film for Olivia Munn's character was really, really off-putting. It was incompetently made. The structure was poor. The action scenes were not fun or exciting. There was no build-up to any sort of suspense. I didn't feel any sort of danger whatsoever. I'm giving The Predator a D.
Can I give you one last thing? That one last thing. Everybody's head yes. explode about this?
Yes.
So quite often, the rules are such that even if Striegel's scenes end up on the cutting room floor, he'll still get residuals.
Yeah.
Wow.
Because it's union. Yeah.
Wow. Okay. Interesting. Moving on to a movie that actually opened up last weekend, but because we were away at the film festivals, I didn't get a chance to review it last week, but I want to review it this week because I kind of like this movie. It's called Peppermint. It stars Jennifer Garner and Joel Gallagher Jr., directed by Pierre Morel. And the movie is about Jennifer Garner's husband and daughter are killed in a massive act of violence. She's a suburban housewife who locks and loads, takes the law into her own hands to avenge their debts. I really kind of like this movie. I thought it was fun. I thought it was great to see Jennifer Garner back in an action movie that was far and above and beyond the action movie she's done before. It's gritty, R-rated, violent film. You know, it's formulaic when it comes to revenge thrillers go. It doesn't do anything new. But Jennifer Garner, she's so sort of gleeful and shows no remorse when she, like, goes after the perpetrators that it was really fun. I thought it was a rousing film. What do you think, Andrew?
So I'm a huge Alias fan. I grew up watching that show. I'm fucking obsessed with Sydney Bristow. So, you know, this was my chance to see Sydney Bristow with a gun and fighting bad guys. I thought it was fun. I thought there were some problems. It was, like you said, it was very formulaic. I knew exactly what was going to happen at most every moment in this film. But seeing, you know, Jennifer Garner back in action scenes, I applaud. Because I thought she handled herself well. It was like, because Alias was over 10 years ago,
yeah,
at least.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was like that time hadn't passed. She pretty much looks exactly the same.
She does.
But as you said, I knew everything that was going to happen in this film. Nothing was really a shocker to me.
No, it wasn't. But getting there was fun because of just the way that Jennifer Garner, like she sort of had like one-liners. I mean, she was an action hero in this movie. But you didn't like this movie,
this
Matt.
This movie's terrible.
Oh, come on!
This movie's terrible. Now, look.
Worse Jennifer, than Predator?
Yeah.
You didn't see it.
Yeah, at least there's nothing about the production that pissed me off in this. this movie I didn't like. It's too formulaic and it feels like there's whole parts of this. I just didn't buy this. Now, what I will say is Jennifer Garner in this particular role, she does well, and she made me think of Harrison Ford in the Indiana Jones movies, where, like, even in the first movie, like, he takes a punch and it hits him. And it's he doesn't just get up and keep going, and he never looks tired. Like, by the end of this movie, she's been through a lot.
Yeah, she gets the shit beat out of her.
Yeah, and I think she does a good job of showing that, and you know, she's not a superhero, right? Like, she really pushes herself, and it's really tough for her to keep going. But now, what I had a couple of problems with is I never really felt like that person that she becomes, like, comes out of nowhere, right? Like, she watches...
Oh, I see your point.
Right, like, you know, she disappears for a long period of time and comes back, and she's, you know, all but John Wick, right?
Right.
And there's...
Jane Wick.
Yeah, there's no... maybe not quite that level. Like, John Wick is almost a superhero, right? She comes back, and she is lethal, and you get, like, the slightest hint of where that comes from, but not enough. And I think, because, sure, okay, maybe she goes through some level of physical training, but you never get any sense of her being a real person and where that drive comes from and what changes,
that part. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like, that either got cut or it was left out of the script, so it's very much... Oh, this happened, you know, she sees her family get killed, and so she just puts it all together that she's gonna train and kill these guys. But what type of person does that, right?
Well, like, you don't see her sort of like, go into the jungles and train and all that stuff.
Or
I get that.
Like, but I don't know that you even need to see that. I wanna know what, because even the cops say this, like, she's a suburban soccer mom. Where's this come from? And there's nothing, there's no hint in her. You never get to know her enough as a person to think,
all of a sudden,
as opposed to a Simple Favor, where you unpeel these pieces of Anna Kendrick's character, where you see there's this darkness in her background, and like, oh, okay, I get where this comes from in her. You never get any sense of that with her, and that, or the bad cop. Like, the bad cop, you never know why he's bad.
I went into this movie with super, super low expectations. And it's, you know, it's not a long film. It's less than an hour and 40 minutes. And I was entertained.
I was entertained.
You know, it was fine. And I just love to see Jennifer Garner in just in a real super badass role. You know, I give it a B. You know, it's a B. It's definitely a B movie that deserves a B rating. Andrew, what's your letter grade?
I would say B.
Okay.
And, I would also say B.
I'm going to give it a D plus.
A D plus.
A D plus.
Well, at least it gets the plus.
The plus.
Okay. Well, new on Blu-ray is a film that got very mixed reviews when it opened. I liked this film, I think more than most people, because it was different. This is Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom, directed by J.A. Bayona. The cast is, of course, obviously Bryce Dallas Howard and Chris Pratt. And the dinosaurs have to be evacuated from the island because the volcano goes off and they're going to be extinct again. So Bryce Dallas Howard, Chris Pratt are, you know, they want to save them. But then what happens? What do you do with them after that? And the movie goes to a very interesting place. It moves the action off the island, because I thought the other sequels, you know, Jurassic Lost World and Jurassic Park 3 and even the first Jurassic World, they kept remaking the same movie.
Yeah.
This one was different. I liked it, and it certainly set up where what could be a very good third Jurassic World movie. But Matt, what did you think?
Remember that news a few years back about the script, the potential Jurassic Park sequel that was going around, where it was like raptors that were armed and being used as super soldiers?
Oh,
I remember like hearing about,
like,
that
10 or 12 years ago. There was some story that, like, somebody's got, oh, it's set in the future and it's going to be the raptors are, you know, they're used as soldiers and they're armed and they're part of this super soldier program. And I felt like, oh, that's what they're trying to set up here. I felt like this was actually, you take a couple of different movies and take pieces out of them and then jam the scripts together. I felt like you had two different things happening here that didn't make all that much sense. Like, realistically, do we have to see them all get off the island? Like, who cares?
Well, they didn't all get off it.
No, I understand that. But just say, like, oh, yeah, it turns out we just took a bunch. I mean, do your whole movie on the mainland. Like, just say, like, all you have to do is set up, like, oh, it turns out Isla Nublar is going to explode. We just transported a bunch. Like, you don't need to see all that.
What do you think of Jurassic World?
I had fun watching that. You know, I love Jurassic Park movies. This one had more dinosaurs, I think, than the other ones. My one problem with it is it got so overly dramatic, especially in the scene with the girl in the bed and the Tyrannosaurus Rex's, like, finger is coming to her. that
well,
part
that's
to me,
just, you know,
that, I know, but that part to me was
sensationalism. Yeah.
Was ridiculous, and I didn't think that part that was necessary. But I did have a blast watching it. There's a shit ton of dinosaurs in it. It's a Jurassic Park film. And it got me kind of excited about what's to come. Obviously, the end credit scene, you know, gives a little spoiler what we might see coming. So I thought it was fun. I was entertained.
You know, the thing about when I saw Jurassic Park 3 back in July of 2001, I wrote a review that is not even online anymore because the website disappeared. But at the end of my review, I said, you know, because like in that film, the raptors, like the intelligence of the dinosaurs was increasing geometrically. They were getting very smart very, very fast. And I thought, what would happen if the dinosaurs, especially the raptors, made it to the mainland? Made it to the mainland. Now, that would be a hell of a Jurassic Park, Jurassic World movie.
Yeah.
And that's certainly what hints we see at the end of Fallen Kingdom. So I kind of feel like if they do make a third film in this Jurassic World series, it could go in the direction of the recent Planet of the Apes movies, mm-hmm. where there's a role reversal mm-hmm. between, just like there was a role reversal between the humans and the apes, now you're looking at a role reversal between the humans and the dinosaurs. And even though that's now been done, because those three apes movies were fantastic, the ones so with Andy Serkis. Yeah. All three were great. I'm actually more excited to see the third Jurassic World movie because of like what we see at the end of Fallen Kingdom.
Well, it can't be any worse than this one.
I liked Fallen Kingdom. I definitely thought that in terms of the sequels, it was the best sequel.
I like this one better than the last one.
I like this one better than it was definitely the best for me. It was my favorite Jurassic movie since the original. You know, the other ones were okay, and Jurassic World, the first Jurassic World, I felt like it was a remake of the first three movies. This was different, and it didn't always work, but it worked enough to give me something different, to make me wonder what was going to happen next, and on that level, I thought it succeeded. So I actually give Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom a B+. Matt?
I think there's hints of an actual decent movie in here. There's stuff that doesn't seem to make any sense. You know, the whole thing with the daughter, the granddaughter, that's just...
See, I like that part.
I did too.
I was like, what?
Yeah, but that's a different movie. Mm-hmm. That's a whole different movie.
But it was a good twist.
Not see that coming, actually. I did not see that she was going to...
No.
Anyway,
I
didn't like it. I'm going to give it a C minus.
All right, Andrew.
I'm going to go B+.
B+.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, you know, it was fine. I enjoyed
it. It's got dinosaurs.
It's
what more do you want, people? Right,
exactly. It's right. Dinosaurs. Least, what more do you want?
They at least get that part right.
Yes. You know, I got to say, you know, doing the show every week, and now that we're back, we're certainly going to be keeping this going every week through the holiday season and beyond. So make sure you do your part. Please help us out. Help us keep Movie Review Talk alive here on Collider Video. Make sure you share this. Make sure you go to our podcast. Make sure you subscribe to it. Make sure you review it. So if you can't watch it, you can certainly listen to it. And make sure you follow me at Movie Mantz and hashtag Movie Review Talk, and also tag Collider Video. Let us know what you thought of the movies we talked about today. Let us know what you think of Movie Review Talk. Again, I'm at Movie Mantz. Where can people find you, fine fellas?
Go ahead, Andrew.
Just my name, at Andrew Freund, Freund. That's me.
And Matt?
You can find me online at Matchity, Matchity. Or if, because some of the Schmodown folks caught me, should you go to Tiki Oasis in next year in San Diego, I'll be there again.
There you go. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for being here on Review Talk. Next week, Michael Moore. Wow, he did Fahrenheit 9/11. Now he is back with Fahrenheit 11/9. Definitely a hot button movie. Lots to talk about with this one. So make sure you join us next week here on Collider Video's Movie Review Talk. Until then, here's looking at you, kid.
Hey everybody, Mark Ellis here. Thanks for watching this episode. You want to watch more? Then click up here. Or you can click right here for more great content from Collider. If you haven't subscribed to Collider Video, do so right now and share this vid with your friends. Thanks for watching.